Let us rise for the processional hymn on this seventh Sunday of Easter, Lift High the Cross, 837, the first four stanzas. The love of Christ proclaim till all the world adore his sacred name. Come, Christian. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our intro at psalmody is printed on the readings insert, and we'll sing that responsively. Come and hear, all you who fear God, and I will tell what he has done for my soul. Shout for joy to God, the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. Bless our God, O peoples. Let the sound of his praise be heard. Okay. Well, it helps to have the correct insert. That's me. Well, I thought, yeah, boy, they don't really sing this for him. They need more coffee? All right. Yeah. Yeah, that is the right date. Thank you, Pastor Ziegler. All right. I should have warned the guest organist that it's always an adventure to serve here. That's right. Well, now I've got the right one, Kristen, so yeah. Yeah, just give me a starting pitch, you know. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud, be gracious to me and answer me. One thing have I asked of the Lord that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For my father and my mother have forsaken me, but the Lord will take me in. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud, be gracious to me and answer me. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly. The Lord be with you.
And also.
Let us pray the collect for this seventh Sunday of Easter. O King of glory, Lord of hosts, uplifted in triumph far above all heavens, leave us not without consolation, but send us the Spirit of truth, whom you promised from the Father. For you live and reign with him and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Be seated for the hearing of God's word.
The first reading for the seventh Sunday of Easter is from Acts chapter 1. Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. And when they had entered, they went up to the upper room where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. All these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer, together with women and Mary the mother of Jesus and his brothers. In those days, Peter stood up among the brothers, the company of persons was in all about 120, and said, "Brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke beforehand by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us, and was allotted his share in the ministry. Now this man bought a field with the reward of his wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle, and all his bowels gushed out. And it became known to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, so that the field was called in their own language, Acheldama, that is, field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, 'May his camp become desolate, and let there be no one to dwell in it, and let another take his office.' So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these men must become with us a witness to his resurrection." And they put forward two, Joseph called Barsabbas, who was also called Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, "You, Lord, who know the hearts of all, show which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. This is the word of the Lord.
To God.
Thank you.
epistle is from 1 John chapter 5. If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God that he has borne concerning his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. And this is the testimony that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. And this is the confidence that we have toward him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the requests that we have asked of him. This is the word of the Lord.
Hallelujah, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Hallelujah, hallelujah. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 17th chapter. Jesus said, Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one even as we are one. While I was with them, I kept them in your name, which you have given me. I have guarded them, and not one of them has been lost except the son of destruction, that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sake, I consecrate myself, that they may also be sanctified in truth. This is the gospel of the Lord.
To thee, O Christ.
We'll confess together the Christian faith at the Nicene Creed, page 158. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men, and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and a life of the world to come. Amen. May be seated. I'd like to invite the children forward. All right, come on up. Well, Well, we are coming to the end of the Easter season. This is the last Sunday of Easter. And in fact, there's something that you'd really have to look hard to find the difference. Something a little different this Sunday up here than there was last Sunday. And it's right over here. Look at this big tall candle. Right? This is lit all during the Easter season, but I know you can't see it, but there's no fire up there today. It's not lit because something happened this past week. Yeah, remember? We had a special service on Thursday called the Ascension of Jesus. To ascend means to go up, right? If you descend, you go down. If you ascend, you go up. Well, Jesus ascended. Where did he go? Yeah, you're right. In fact, I'm going to show you a picture about that. He goes back to heaven. That's a picture of Jesus ascending up into the clouds, just like you said, see? And who's these people below? Who do you think that is? Disciples, right. They watched him go up. He blessed them, and then he went up into heaven, up into a cloud. And that's why this Sunday we don't have this lit, because it's always lit in Easter until the ascension. That goes out, right? But Jesus, before he ascends, promised to send us the Holy Spirit. And because we're waiting on that, we're waiting to light this candle again till next Sunday to remind us of the coming of the Holy Spirit. So next Sunday will be a special day, and it'll be called Pentecost. And that will be the day we celebrate the Holy Spirit. But today is the last Sunday of Easter. And now what do you think? Jesus ascended into heaven. Does that mean he's just gone away? No, he's still with us, right? Yeah. So let's pray and give thanks for that. Lord, we thank you that you are still with us, that you still care for us, that you reign from heaven over all your church, and that you bless these, your children. We pray your continued blessing upon them and their families, that you would be with each one of us, strengthen us, help us, and send us the Holy Spirit each day to guard our lives and to grant us your peace and your knowledge. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Okay, I suppose you like some candy, huh? Let's see what we have here. Okay. Look at that. So you watch for next Sunday, okay? Because then next Sunday with Pentecost, that candle will be lit again.
Yeah. Thank you,
Oh, you're welcome. Sure. Our hymn of the day, 553, O Christ, our hope, our heart's desire. O Christ, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Joy fulfilled in Christ. And our sermon text, these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. You may be seated. So it was about 6 weeks ago that we celebrated Easter Sunday. And already here we are at the seventh Sunday of Easter. We've come to the end of this joyful Easter season, but our joy does not end. In fact, in this life, regardless of how wonderful it might be, we have only just begun to know real joy. Real joy, well, it's known through Jesus. Real joy is found in believing that we are now children of God, friends of the Savior, he who is risen from the dead and ascended to the throne of God. The joy that we know now, wonderful though it is, that's like what St. Paul described in one place as like looking through a glass darkly. We only see just a small point of the light that God has in store for those who love him. The joy of knowing him face to face. But this gospel lesson, taken from the 17th chapter of John, is part of all those events of Maundy Thursday, the night on which he is betrayed. And there they are in the upper room, nervous about all the tensions seemingly around Jesus in Jerusalem. And Jesus is praying for his disciples. Though he's the one that will bear the brunt of the arrest and the humiliation and beating and cross, suffering and death of the next day, yet the disciples are worried and Jesus is interceding for their sake. He is their master and their teacher, and yet that night he had insisted on washing all their feet. And Peter objects. Jesus tells him simply, if I don't wash you, you will have no part in me. So he goes around the room, washing their feet, and the disciples, shocked as they were at this, must be thinking about what Jesus had said earlier that same week. Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. Whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. So our Lord became their servant that night, the servant of all. He took the lowest place among them because he is the greatest of all. And that night that we remember the giving of the Last Supper, the Lord's Supper, and the sacrament of the altar, all these things are happening. In some ways, it must have been a puzzling situation for those disciples. Now, consider that these men have been to Passover meals probably every year their entire life from their childhood. And the Passover is a liturgy. It's the same one, the same readings, the same prayers. There's some sections for the father of the house to comment on the readings, but it's the same liturgy every year. And Jesus begins in that same liturgy but ends in a wholly different place because he becomes the fulfillment of the Passover lambs. And he points it now to a new covenant, a new testament in his blood. So they're surprised because the meal doesn't end the way they remembered the Passover ending. At Passover, the readings tell about how the Lord delivered his people from what? From slavery in Egypt, right? And how the Pharaoh had kept them under bondage, and the Lord sets them free. But all that only pointed forward to a much greater liberation. Now a new deliverance is taking place. Jesus delivering them from something much more terrible than earthly slavery. Jesus delivering us from slavery to sin. And the outcome, death and damnation. That's what Jesus had come to deliver from. And everything then is about to change. This new covenant in his blood is about to be made through a sacrificial death on the cross, the perfect lamb offered for us. So he changes the liturgy that night and interprets the Passover and lamb in terms of himself. Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Take and drink, this is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Now, Jesus is doing everything differently that night. Even things like the cup. The disciples at a Passover meal are not accustomed to sharing a cup. Each person had their own. But Jesus makes a point telling them, drink from this one cup. And they drink from the one cup because they are to be one in him. All the disciples made one, one body, the church. But most troubling of all that night is Jesus' talk that one would betray him. So there they are, all gathered around the table, and he says, one of you will betray me. And they wonder, who will it be? Surely, not I, Lord. Is it I, Lord? They go around the table puzzled. And they wonder, well, what now will happen in Jerusalem? They see, they feel the tension. They've seen the interactions between Jesus and the chief priests and the scribes, and they know he is despised by these leaders. And so they're worried, probably much for themselves. But what about us when troubles, when worries come? Do we trust the one who is able to calm the storm by his very word? Or do we start frantically looking for our own solutions to things? For them and for us today, Jesus prayed, Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one even as we are one. Keep them in your name, the divine name, the name before which every knee must bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. So why do we, as children of God, why do we worry when troubles come? For they shall and they must. Is it that we doubt? Do we doubt the Lord cares for us? But see, even on this night before his betrayal, how the Lord cares, how he prays and intercedes for us to his Father in heaven. But his prayer is not that you would have a life without troubles, is it? His prayer is not, oh, take them out of the world that they never have any sort of troubles. No, that's not how he prays, that we'd be spared trouble. It's not how he prays, oh, that you're somehow spared sorrows for this life. No, that's part of this fallen world. It was part of the world for him, and it will be also for us as his disciples. For he himself is not spared sorrow or trouble or grief. Instead, Jesus prays, the Father will guard and keep us from the power of Satan, from the evil one, from sin, and from despair and unbelief. He prays so that we may have his joy fulfilled in us, even in the midst of a broken age, joy fulfilled. So he prays for our protection, because he knows well the fallenness of this world. Those who are of the world, as he uses the phrase, call evil good. And they call good evil. The world despises God's grace. And more than that, it gets more personal. I have given them your word, says Jesus, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world. Well, it's not only about these first 12 men, is it? It's about you and I. The world has hated them because I have given them your word. So it should be no surprise that oftentimes Christians are hated by the world, persecuted by the world. You know, we're not really used to seeing much of that in our own country, but it's rampant in other parts of the world. So those words ought to give us pause. If it seems sometimes like Christians are slighted or treated unfairly. The world hates this because we are not of the world. And Jesus has thus told us ahead of time. But have no fear, for we are marked with the name of God in holy baptism. He has prayed, keep them in your name. That is like a brand of ownership. We belong to God, and he protects us from the evil one. Since we belong to him, we are blessed with joy. These things I speak in the world, that they may have joy fulfilled in themselves. So no matter the temporary troubles of the world, though they are many, we know the end of the story, that God's people are victorious, and not out of our own great effort or piety or wisdom by any sense. We are victorious because Christ has won the victory for our future. He says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. It is his victory. We live and we serve in these vocations to which God has brought us because he has called us to serve others in his name. And we do it with joy because we know we have a place prepared for us with him. And we are sent then to lead lives that hallow God's name. Even as we confess in the small catechism, in the first petition of the Lord's Prayer, hallowed be thy name. Now, how often we pray the Lord's Prayer and we sometimes forget to slow down and think about the meanings. Hallowed be thy name. The catechism asks, how is God's name kept holy? God's name is kept holy when the word of God is taught in its truth and purity, and we as the children of God also lead holy lives according to it. Help us to do this, dear Father in heaven. But anyone who teaches or lives contrary to God's word profanes the name of God among us. Protect us from this, our heavenly Father. So in Christ, our lives, they have great purpose. They are filled with joy, even in the midst of troubles. Even in the midst of the world's hostile, our Lord's joy comes. The world's hostility may come as well, but our Lord's joy belongs to you. Your name has been called. His name has been placed upon you. So you need not live in anxieties or fears. We live in joy. The Son of God prays for our salvation, and he is ascended above the heavens. And he comes. And he comes this day to feed his flock, you gathered here, to forgive us our sins, to give us grace to trust in him so that we may have his joy fulfilled in ourselves. Now may the peace of God that passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We rise for the prayers of the church. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. I want to use some of the prayers. We've been encouraging prayer card requests from the congregation. I have the prayers here. I'll just use some of those as well this morning. Our Father in heaven, we thank you on this final Sunday of this joyful season for the resurrection of your Son, for the blessing that he has brought to us through the forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation. We pray for all gathered here, for all our congregation, for all throughout the world who call upon your holy name. Guard us and keep us in your name. Lord, in your mercy. And we pray for sister congregations in our Metro Denver area, especially Resurrection in the City, as they begin the process of rebuilding the ministry there. Lord, bless the people and pastor at Resurrection in the City and bring new people to hear the good news of salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for those who are in need of healing. For those who are receiving treatment or recovering from such, remembering Wayne Smith, Mike Welter and Gordon Welter, Andy Sykes and Carol Lively, Pam, Robin and Kim, Emily, Jesse, Connie and Pat, Glenn, Cindy and Diana. And here we add names which are known to us of those who are in need of healing, strength, or comfort. Lord, in your mercy, we pray, O Lord, that you would abide in your mercy with those who grieve the loss of a friend or a loved one. We pray for the families of Val Osborne and Catherine Stratman, mourning the passing of these mothers and grandmothers. O Lord, watch over them and give them hope in your word. Lord, in your mercy, bless our nation. Watch over those who serve in our armed forces. Protect us from danger and harm. Give your guarding presence also to our first responders. Protect them in their duties as police, sheriff's department, and firefighters. Lord, in your mercy. Father, into your hands, we remember all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we'll continue with the offertory, page 159. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and it is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who after his resurrection appeared openly to all his disciples and in their sight was taken up into heaven, that he might make us partakers of his divine life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, 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 Lord. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Of God you take away the sin. Gifts that you have given have filled our hearts with rest. Let us rise. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. And sing his praise, tell everyone what he has done. Let all who seek the Lord rejoice and proudly bear his name. He recalls his promises, leads his people forth in joy. Shouts of thanksgiving. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Maybe seated for a couple of announcements and things before our recessional hymn. All right, Bo, do you want to go first? Do you want me to? I'm up. Okay. All right. Just a couple of brief things here, and I'll turn it over to you, Bo. And let's see here. All right. Just a couple of things coming up as far as changes. We won't be having the all-mass services on Saturday night for at least a while. For various reasons, I'll be out of town a couple of those Saturdays. And then we're going to have some family in for a big party on June 6th, you are all invited to an open house. We have three graduates in the Murphy family this year. So a son, daughter, son-in-law, all graduate in college. So on June 6th from 3 to about 9, we'll have an open house and invite you all to come over and just enjoy and celebrate the day. So other things coming up. The softball team might get to play a game if it doesn't rain on them, and they might even win. So does anyone know what's our schedule? I mean, or what's our record? 0-1. Well, okay. You can see that this group hasn't been praying for our team enough. Well, I want to thank the Capital Campaign team, Bo and your whole team. It's been amazing how capably you led us through a very high-speed effort, and I'm excited to see what has gone on. They have really worked faithfully on your behalf as the congregation to show us both the needs that we have for more rooms and really the unique opportunity we have at this time to partner with the high school in terms of the leasing of the space during the week. Well, today, as you probably know, is Commitment Sunday, where we are prayerfully and joyfully making pledges for financial gifts over and above our regular giving. And it can be spread out over the next 3 years, however it works for you. And we've heard, you know, from several of our members about stewardship. And you know, it's people write books about this. Not very many people read those books, but all kinds of people write them. It's really nothing more than realizing that all that we have, all that we are, belongs to God. It's our responsibility to use what we've been given to serve God. And you know, over the years, sometimes you think pastors come out of the seminary like we're supposed to know all these things. And no, we learn and grow in the faith just like any of you do. And over the years, I've learned to trust the Lord to provide for whatever I need. Yeah, you come out and you don't really know sometimes, you know, what it'll be like to be a pastor in the church and how you will learn over all those years to trust the Lord. Your whole life, we learn to continue and to grow in that trust and that faith. But I have seen the Lord provide for me, for my family, for congregational needs over the years that I never could have predicted. How gracious his care has been. I would just say, you know, some people like to talk about, you know, tithes and percentages. I don't usually get into all that. I just simply believe generosity is part of being a Christian. It's important. It shows that we trust the Lord to provide. It's a way, generosity, that we can give thanks to him. So I would just encourage every household, trust the Lord. Be generous. Let Christians be known for generosity in all the things you do, the way that you treat people at work, the way that your kids treat people at school. Show generosity. Show kindness. Be willing to listen. That's what we ought to be known for as Christians. So it's generosity, but not merely by any means in, you know, commitments that we make today. I encourage, really be generous in how you treat people. You know, it ought to be that the restaurants look forward to the crowds of Christians on Sunday afternoon because they're generous tippers. But I've been told that isn't the way it is. But it should be that way. We should be generous in all things. Because our Lord has been so generous to us. So thank you and God bless you. And Bo, yeah.
I'm going to try to keep it pretty quick here, just because we have really a bit of a feast today. I do want to highlight, hopefully, that you guys have noticed that there are commitment cards in the pews or underneath along with the hymnals. And so if you haven't had a chance to take a look at that, please do. And you can return these either to the offering plate in the rear of the sanctuary or in the box that's towards the entryway of the church. But we'll talk a little bit more about this during the Sunday school hour. But really, our focus for our Sunday school hour is fellowship. That we're getting ready, and I'll have a little bit more information on the progress of the building. So please do stay with us. We'll go through that. We'll talk a little bit about the commitments that we make as a congregation with one another. And then, like I mentioned, after the closing hymn here, they'll roll up the gates, and there's a pretty good feast for this morning. So please stay and join us.
All right, thank you, Bo. And our recessional hymn, 837, the last two verses, 5 and 6. Enjoy the fellowship. The Lord be with you.